Chambers tonight, and I'm sitting beside Holly all evening. And she said nothing whatsoever about that. Now I'm afraid to go sit beside her when I'm finished talking. I don't know what's going to happen. Anyway, this time last year I was lucky enough to be telling stories. I was attending a conference representing Storytellers of Ireland in Spain. And when it was finished, we all went down to Guadalajara, which is 22nd year, I think, this year, having a storytelling marathon where they tell stories for 36 hours or something like that, non-stop. There's more than 1,000 storytellers to tell stories, and I was lucky enough to be one of them last year. And a bit like following everybody else on, everybody was on telling in Spanish. Naturally enough, being in Guadalajara in Spain, I started talking in Dublinese. The miracle is that anybody understood me at all. But a fella introduced me to a girl the following day, and he said she loved your story, so I started to speak to her, and she had no English whatsoever. So I don't know, maybe it was the body language or something that she was. So I thought maybe I'd tell you the story that I told this time last year. And I salute the storytellers who are there this week. They're all over there again for the 22nd Storytelling Marathon. So if you're ever in Spain and you're down that way, it's a really unique thing. The whole town closes down for storytelling. And it's one storyteller after another, 5 minutes each, and you're off. And they have a great way of stopping you when you're gone over your 5 minutes. They don't need little buzzers. They switch off the microphone. And there was a friend of mine, and she was too long-winded, and she was talking, and she came to this point, and she said, "And there was silence!" And they switched off the microphone. And she was trying to tell the truth. I thought it was very funny, but she didn't. It was funny. Anyway, this is a true story. There was a fellow called Liam, and he was married, and he didn't see it coming, but his wife took off with somebody else and left him a note to say she was gone, his dinner was in the fridge. And he kind of knew that from the letter, from the way she was gone, and she vanished, more or less, all his life. She couldn't be bothered looking for anything or sorting things out. She was gone, she was happier where she was. And he was there for a while, and he had a big old house that he had inherited from his own people, and it was a rambling house, so he decided he'd turn it into a bit of a guest house or a bed and breakfast. So that was a great idea, but older houses don't naturally lend themselves to bed and breakfast or to places of business, so he had to get in a local contractor who was called Jack Ladd. And Jack will do anything under the sun, but he'll never do anything right, nor will he finish it. So he was asked, would he come in and consult about bathrooms, because we're in the modern times now, and if you're in the bed, you need the bathroom beside you. You can't walk 5 feet away to use a bathroom. Always reminds me, in a strange classic way, of the last century when they had chamber pots in the rooms and you didn't walk anywhere. Now you have ensuite bathrooms, much the same thing, only it's a different thing. There's a door in the way. Very same thing. But anyway, he was asked to come in and provide ensuite facilities for everybody. So that was easy enough. Liam had a room upstairs and he was going to sleep in it, and it was like a suitcase with a door on it, and that was he, happy enough, single man, he was in there. And he got one room done into a smaller room, knocked into the next room, and that was one room with an ensuite. Now, so there was another room downstairs, and he could turn that into a kind of a spare parlour, they'd call it. And he could turn that into a bedroom, but there was no bathroom in it. So he said, "Ask Jack Ladd, would you do that for him?" So he did. But the only thing he forgot to do, he had to build on an extension, you have to understand that. He had to build on an extension on the ground floor into the side garden for a bathroom. And then he forgot to put a door from that into the bedroom. So now you have a bathroom and you have a bedroom, but no access between the two. So if you want to use them, you have to go down the hall, out the door, around the side, and down again. Sort yourself out, back out, down the hall, down the side, back in the door, back down the hall, into the bed. So I'm just only telling you that, you might be wondering what the archaeology and the architecture of the place has to do with it, but it's very important for what happened after that. Because one wet, windy night, shortly thereafter, when he was after advertising in 5 parishes around the place looking for custom and getting none, a fella knocked on the door, and the fella's name was O'Shane. And O'Shane used to go to school with Liam, but he was after him put out of his own house by his wife. who decided that he'd been playing away. And when he came home, the door, the locks were changed on the door, and he couldn't get in. And his clothes were in the front garden, and they were soaked. And so he went up to Liam then, and he said, "Can I stay here for a while?" So Liam said, "Yes, but you have to pay." There's a rule, Brussels rule, you're in the EU rule, that you have to stay for a certain month anyway, and you have to pay 2 weeks in advance. Now, you only have breakfast, you only order one night or two nights. The woman calmed down. But anyway, he agreed that. And Liam had a way of cutting out waste altogether, because it was breakfast, he'd go around and he'd say to the guests at night, "Will you be having breakfast in the morning?" And they'd say, "Yeah." And most people in this country, if we're at home, we eat the minimum and we're gone, or we don't eat anything at all. But for away, we eat a Christmas dinner for breakfast. We call it an Irish breakfast. We have a full Irish breakfast. You could be eating till 11 o'clock. And so that's why he cut that out. So we used to go around the night before and say, "We have breakfast here." "What's our breakfast?" "An Irish breakfast, yeah." "Will you have an egg?" "How many eggs will you have?" "Or like one egg, 2 eggs, whatever it was." "Will you have a rasher?" "How many rashers will you have?" "And then sausage." And you go down through the whole lot and you take them off. And when you come down the next morning, that's what was on your plate. There was no question of getting more than that. But then he'd go out and he'd buy in the shop just that amount. He'd buy 4 eggs and 2 rashers and a sausage in the shop. He had to deal with the grocer down the road and he'd bring them in. So things went down like that for a while, and about a week or so after that, there was another knock on the door, and there was another man after being pegged out of his house, and his name was Frank. And Frank came in, and he was the third man off a football team that they all were in when they were younger. So the three of them knew one another, and the same carry on went down. "Will you have a rasher? Will you have an egg? Will you have a sausage?" And they were there for a while, and then Frank was like... These were all men now that had been married and had a full love life, and now there were 3 bachelors living in the house and a no love life. So Frank started getting a bit edgy, and he says to Liam one night, he says, "If I want to bring home a woman friend to the room, would that be all right?" And he said, "Yeah, that'd be all right, but she'd have to pay for the breakfast, and many eggs do you think she needs? And many rashers, and does she like the sausages or what?" So Frank wasn't on for paying for the breakfast for anybody that he might bring home, because he didn't know whether he'd stay the full night or whether he'd all get fed up with one another and that'd be all right after half an hour. So a row started then between the two of them, and the agreement was arrived at anyway that Frank said if he didn't come home and he went to the lady friend's house and didn't come home, he didn't think that he should pay for the breakfast anyway, because he wasn't going to eat the breakfast in Liam's house. So that's the class of high class wrangling and negotiation that was going on in the house. So they agreed anyway on a compromise, and it doesn't matter what the compromise was, they just agreed on a compromise. So a couple of weeks later anyway, Frank arrives home with a girl called Karen. And Karen was a game girl, she wasn't, she's still alive and she's still rattling around the place. I know her, I can introduce you to her if you like. She's a game girl, but she's a girl that likes to live around the place, you know. And so she came home anyway with Frank. And Frank had the upstairs room that had the ensuite. And Oisin had the downstairs room that you had to wander around the thing and all the rest of it. Because Liam was no fool and he had an idea that there might be complications with Frank and he'd need the ensuite bathroom. So anyway, they enjoyed themselves, we'll call it that then, and sure you know yourself. If you ever enjoyed yourself with another person, this was better than that. The best time you ever had it was even better than that again. And so they fell asleep in the exhaustion of human beings. And they were lying in the bed, and there was a bathroom call for Karen. So she had to get up anyway. So she went out into the hall and she went into the ensuite. Now, what I forgot to tell you is this, that when Jackson Ladd knocked the ball into the bedroom and made the ensuite bathroom, he left the door of the bathroom into the hall as well, right? So you could actually go on a circular motion between two rooms all night. You go down the hall, in the door, in the bathroom, you know, and go around like that, sorry. And so she went in anyway, and that was okay. But in coming out, what happened only, didn't she walk out into the hall? And then she got a bit confused, because before they got to the house, they had been enjoying themselves in various places around the town. And she wasn't entirely certain where she was. So she wandered around the place, found herself down the stairs and in the door, and she went in, and here was a snoring man in the bed, fast asleep. Only it was Usher and it wasn't Frankie. She was after going into the wrong room. So she got into the bed, and of course Usher had been in sleep, deep sleep, wondering when he ever was going to get back to his normal life as a man. Suddenly, a naked woman rolls into the bed beside him. And she puts her arm around him, and he put his arm around her, and then the rest followed naturally. And the way they were going, like the hammers of hell. And she started to roar, and she started to call out Frank's name. And Usher was wondering what the name of Christ she was calling out Frank for. And Frank woke up and heard her calling down the stairs. So he thought she was in trouble. So down he staggers and he wanders into Usher's room, where he finds the two of them flying. So he leapt into the bed and started to thump Usher in the pitch black. Usher started to thump him back because he thought he was an intruder or a burglar breaking in, because he thought he was back at home in his own house. And Karen just stood there and screamed, because no matter what happened, she was on a winner. Whoever won, she was happy. But she didn't know who was fighting. So then, lo and behold, the door opens and in runs Liam with a hurley. Because he didn't know what was happening. So he started lashing into everybody. And Karen stood back against the wall, because now there was three naked men fighting one another in a pitch black room. As far as she could make out, she was going to be the winner of one of the three, if not two out of three. I don't know what she had in her mind. Someone was going by, heard the screeching and the roar, and looked in, saw the figures jumping up and down, and rang the guards. Guards came down and arrested all four of them. Brought them off down to the barracks and brought them to court the next morning. And the judge gave them all the probation act, because he said he couldn't figure out who was attacking who, and Karen couldn't identify anybody. Now that they had their clothes on. If it was dark and there was nothing on, that was a different thing, but in the situation she was in. So anyway, the two lads left the place. They got a refund of the eggs money and the rashers money and the sausage money, and off they went. And you would think that was the end of it. But Karen decided that she'd move in with Liam. And from that day to this, the two of them are there in the house, and they're running the bed and breakfast. And they're booked up for a year in advance, so I don't know what extra services is being provided in that house. But I'll tell you this much. There's hardly a stag party comes to that part of Dublin that doesn't stay in that house at some stage. Well, that's the end of the story that I told last year in Spain. And how in the name of God anybody understood what I said? Well, a woman came up to me afterwards and said that was a great story. And she didn't speak English. So thank you very much.